Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see you this morning. I'm so glad that you are here to worship with us this early service this morning. We're a few, but it's going to be a great time of worship today here at Life Springs. Would you stand with me? We're going to pray this morning as we begin to worship today. Lord Jesus, I thank you for these folks who are here, and I thank you that you've brought us together today to worship you, to give honor and glory to your name. And so we give ourselves to you. We give all of ourselves to you in worship today. We want to see you move powerfully in this place today. God, I pray for those who are on their way. I pray that this will be a great gathering together of believers this morning as we worship you and as we give you praise. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Everybody said, amen. Well, it is just good to be with you this morning. We're just going to continue. We're going to worship and praise him this morning. I want to invite you to sing with us.
Thank you.
Here with us last week, welcome back. If you're here for the first time, back with us in person, welcome to church. We're so glad to have you. It's amazing to be able to stand together and sing and praise. So let's lift our voices this morning and worship Him.
There is no fear. There is no doubt, 'cause I have seen Your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. I have a hope found in Your name. I have a strength found in Your grace.
Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones.
Don't we serve a good God? He's such a faithful God. And I love that. Do what you are famous for. He's famous for making a difference in people's lives. I hope that that's what you experience today as you worship with us. We serve a God who wants to make a difference in your life. Maybe you're a guest with us today. I just want to say a special welcome. I'm glad that you are here. As you came in today, if this is your first time, you might have seen folks helping sign in the door. They had some of these tumblers. And if you're a guest here, I'd love to be able to get you one. And just to say thank you for being with us today. If you didn't receive one, you can meet us out at any door as you leave today. We'd love to get you a gift just to say thank you for being here with us and worshiping with us this morning. I think it's a great privilege to have you with us today. You know, we talked last week about how some things have changed, and you know that we're not passing the offering plate anymore here in our church service, but I want to remind you that at the back of each aisle, there's a black box on the wall, and if you've come prepared to give, you can drop your offerings in that box anytime during the morning as you're here. That'll be an opportunity for us to give. You know, there's envelopes there if you want to fill that in. As well, there's something else in the pocket of those boxes. There's these little cards that say prayer request. I just want you to know, if there's a need in your life, there's some way that we could join you in praying. We want to be able to do that. You can fill that card in, and you can just drop it there in the box as well, and that will let us know. We can share those with our prayer team, and we can just go to God together with you as we serve God. So I wanted to make sure that you knew about that. You know, there's one other announcement that I want to talk to you about today. In just a couple weeks, on Sunday the 25th, is going to be our annual meeting here at the church. That's a meeting where we're going to gather together. We'll spend some time in prayer. We will look at our elder candidates for the upcoming term. We'll take a vote to approve those elders. We'll also approve the church budget for the coming year. That's going to be on Sunday the 25th. We're going to do that meeting after our second service, okay? Sunday the 25th, after second service, will be that annual meeting. I'd love to invite you. I'd love for you to be involved. As you are thinking about that, today when you leave, when you go out in the lobby, on the tables on this left-hand side over here, there are a couple of documents out there on the table. One of them is the budget for the next year. You can grab one to look over that, so that if you had questions or you wanted to look over it before the annual meeting, that's available. The other thing that's out there are biographies of the elder candidates. We want you to be able to meet the people that are our candidates for our elders, and so their information is out there as well. I'd love for you to be able to check that stuff out as we look forward to that meeting on the 25th. So a lot of great things happening, and I want you to be a part of it. You know, every week as we gather here to worship God, I hope that you come with an attitude of expectation, expecting that God is going to speak into your life, that as you worship him, he's going to do something wonderful. I know that he is doing that, and I know that he's doing that this morning. He's moving in this place so that his word can be planted in our hearts. You know, as we worship this morning, we're going to sing a song that says that he's moving in this place, but that he's here. And I don't know what situation you find yourself in today, but I want you to know that he's here. He's walking with you. And the song says that he's a way maker, a miracle worker, and a promise keeper. And you can rely on him today as we continue to worship. Let me invite you to find a posture that is appropriate for worship. You can stand, you can sit, you can kneel. However that is, as we continue to worship today, I want to invite you to do that as we sing to our miracle worker.
all, Father. What can I say but thank you? Thank you for keeping every word you've ever given us. Thank you for always finding a way for us to continue our journey with you, Lord. Just thank you for being the way maker to allow all of us to be here today, Lord. For keeping your promise that you are going to heal us, that you are going to move us forward, Lord, that we can always count on you. That you move through us, Lord. That no matter what, you are famous for making a difference. Lord, I just ask that you send your Holy Spirit, Lord, to Pastor Roger as he delivers your word. And I ask that the Holy Spirit moves through this congregation as they receive the word that was meant for them. Lord, I just thank you for everything that you're doing with us, the blessings that you have pouring upon us, Lord, the way that you're there, Lord. We just thank you for all of this, Lord, and we just lay this at your son's feet, and we ask all of this in your son's name, Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, and good to see you. How many of this is your first time since the lockdown ended and we were able to have church? How many of your first time back? Can I see your hands? Most of you here? Yep, a few of you. A couple of people. Good. Most of you were here last week. It's good to see you, and welcome back. It is good to be here having live services again, and we hope we just continue to build and reach more people. We're in a series that's based on the Ten Commandments, and we're moving into the seventh commandment today. Now, just imagine you're driving in a city that you're unfamiliar with, and you want to get on the freeway, but you're a little bit turned around, and you don't know exactly where to go, and you come up to a road, and it looks like it leads onto the freeway, but you're not sure if it's an on-ramp or an off-ramp. Aren't you glad in that moment that someone was thoughtful enough to put up a sign that said, "Wrong way, do not enter"? Because if you were to turn in what you thought was an on-ramp and as an off-ramp, you could really do yourself some serious bodily harm. There could be great damage to your car as well as to the car and the person that's coming off the freeway driving in the right direction. That's a good analogy for the seventh commandment. The seventh commandment is like a warning sign at the bottom of the off-ramp. This is the wrong way to happiness, God's saying. This is the wrong way to the mutually fulfilling marriage. This is the wrong way to find the love that your heart longs for. Many people do not like the seventh commandment, however. Nevertheless, God gave it to us because in his wisdom, he knows what's best for all of us, and this commandment is for our protection. The seventh commandment is that warning sign. Don't go this way. Here's what it says in Exodus chapter 20, verse 14. Simply, you must not commit adultery. Nothing destroys a family faster than adultery. The seventh commandment is God's protection plan for the family. God says, I don't want you committing adultery because it shatters the trust of the people you love. It pulverizes the security that God intended for a family to have, and it enslaves the one who commits it. And God says, it will always be wrong in my eyes. Even the mere mention of this word this morning, I understand, can cause some of you some painful memories because you were the one who was cheated on. For others, the mention of this word brings some guilt and shame. The purpose of today's message is not to resurrect the past. If you have trusted Christ as your Savior, if you've confessed your sin to God, then you've been forgiven. God has forgiven you, and He has wiped your slate clean. That's the amazing thing that God does. That's just His grace, that you can be completely forgiven and made to appear before God as if you'd never sinned. You need to forgive yourself because God has already forgiven you. The Bible says there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So don't let Satan keep condemning you for the things that are in your past that have already been covered by the blood of Jesus that was shed on the cross for you. So today, I want us to focus on the future. I want to talk to you about how to affair-proof your marriage. You need to understand, God is not anti-sex. God invented sex. Was created by the cleanest mind in the universe, but He created it for a purpose. And like everything else that God created, it can be used in the right way or it can be used in the wrong way. He wants you to experience sex in the right context, inside a marriage relationship between a man and a woman. God wants to use sex as a tool to build a healthy and strong marriage. And God says there will be serious consequences for misusing what He intended to be a blessing for a husband and a wife. Look at this verse found in Hebrews chapter 13, beginning in verse 4. God says, marriage should be honored by all and the marriage bed kept pure, for God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. So today, let's focus on the future. How can we avoid the heartache and betrayal of adultery, as well as avoiding God's discipline or judgment? I want us to consider 6 steps to safeguard your marriage. Here are 6 things that you can do to affair-proof your marriage. So if you have your notes, get them out, follow along with me. The first one is you need to make a commitment to live by God's standards. That means you're going to say, I'll wait to have sex until I'm married. And when I'm married, I'll be faithful to my spouse until we are separated by death. The Bible says that sex is for marriage only, not before marriage, not outside of marriage. Regardless of your past failures, you can make your fresh start in this regard today. Today can be the beginning of your fresh start. No matter what's happened in the past, you can decide today you are going to live from this day forward as someone who's going to adhere to God's standards. You can say, I'm going to make a commitment, but to live my sexuality in the way that God designed it for a marriage relationship and limit it to that. Psalm 119 verse 9 says, how can a young person stay pure? By obeying your word and following its rules. That's what God says. God's standard is very clear in His word. Adultery is never an option. Under no circumstances is adultery okay. No matter what kind of rationalization someone might have, it's always wrong. There's no justification for it, no matter what your circumstances. You go back to the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis, where you'll find a great character by the name of Joseph. And when Joseph was a slave in Egypt, his master's wife tried to seduce him to go to bed with her. And he had every reason in the world to give in to this temptation. Even though he knew it was wrong, it had been very easy for him to rationalize and say, you know, I'm young, and God has given me this powerful sex drive. What's the harm in expressing it? Or I'm single and I'm a slave in a foreign country. I'll never get married here. Or I'm so far from home, no one back home will ever find out or know. While being sexually active is perfectly acceptable in this culture, she wants it, I want it, my body desires it. I've been emotionally and physically abused. I'm love starved. My mother died when I was young. My father overindulged my life. I had a terrible family life. And all of that would have been true, but it would not be justification for disobeying God's standard for sexual expression. So instead, Joseph said, I will not sin against my God. And the Bible says when he was tempted, when this woman was putting on her strongest effort to seduce him. He simply turned and ran out of the house. Maybe that's what you need to do also, is to put some distance between you and the temptations you're facing. You might say, but my wife or my husband is not meeting my needs. And while that is a problem that needs to be addressed, it is no excuse to sin against God. When our first child, Luke, was born, we were really happy, you know, as parents, to welcome our very first child into our home. But Sherry had a real difficult delivery. And as a result of that delivery, she was incapable of meeting my sexual needs for months and months. I thought it was never going to end. Young man at the time, 25 years old. Finally, after 6 months of waiting, our doctor realized that there was no improvement, and she had to be readmitted to the hospital for reparative surgery. Following surgery, there was another 3 months of waiting for her to recover from surgery. So for 9 months, there was no way that she could meet my sexual needs. But that was no excuse for me to go out and sin. Look at this verse in Proverbs chapter 5, verse 15. Be faithful to your own wife and give your love to her alone. That's in Scripture, and it's not a suggestion. If you want to take the first step in fair-proofing your marriage, I'm suggesting that here today you make a commitment to God. But not only to God, that you go home and you make a commitment to your spouse. I've decided that by God's grace, regardless of what you do, the decision you make, the choices you make, or whatever happens in our marriage, I will never be unfaithful to you. I meant my marriage vows, and when I said forsaking all others, I meant it. It's my conviction that this is always going to be God's will for me, so I've committed myself to live God's way. Regardless of what you do, I will never be unfaithful to you. Friends, if you'll say that and mean it, that'll bring the kind of security into your marriage that's going to cause your love to grow and flourish. And that's exactly what God designed the marriage relationship to be, a place of love and security. So number two, the second thing you can do is to magnify the consequences. Paint a vivid picture in your mind of the devastation and the destruction that's caused by sexual sin. Get out a piece of paper and start making a list of all the things you will lose. You need to have firmly printed on your mind the fact that sexual sin leaves permanent scars. Look at this verse from Proverbs 6, verse 32. The man who commits adultery is an utter fool, for he destroys himself. What a fool. What a fool. Nothing damages emotions like sexual sin. Nothing. Now, sin is sin for sure. But sexual sin leaves permanent scars. The shame doesn't seem to go away. Deep wounds inflicted on everyone involved is enormous. Spouses, kids, friends, the church family, are all wounded by the sin of unfaithfulness. As a pastor, more times than I care to remember, I've been there to help pick up the pieces after an affair. And words cannot describe the deep wounds caused by marital unfaithfulness. Words cannot describe the scars that children carry when mommy or daddy runs off with another person. There are painful wounds. So much damage is done. And this is especially true of Christian marriages. The betrayal of trust shatters the very foundation and the security of every other life in that home. All for the momentary pleasure of a muscle spasm. No wonder the Bible says, the person who commits adultery is an utter fool. Remember Esau, Jacob and Esau in the Old Testament? Esau was the guy who came back from a hunting trip and was so hungry he sold his birthright for a bowl of bean soup, basically. I've known people who are just as short-sighted and just as controlled by their appetites, who are selling their life away for a few momentary moments of pleasure. They are oblivious to the consequences their actions carry. Proverbs 6:26 says, adultery will cost a man all he has. Some of you are in difficult marriages. Maybe you're struggling. And maybe a satisfaction marriage looks like it's nowhere in sight. And so in your heart, you're looking around. You need to hear this. No matter how difficult maintaining, restoring, repairing, and making the marriage that you are in work and work well and be mutually satisfying, no matter how difficult it seems, no matter how high the cost, you need to know the cost of adultery is always higher. Always. Satan tempts us with the pleasure of sin, but he keeps the price tag hidden until you've taken the bait. Everyone loses when there's an affair. And so God put this commandment in the top 10 for our benefit. He says, follow my rules for living, and I can spare your life from enormous heartache. I've been married now almost 44 years to my wife. I'm glad you're still cheering. That's encouraging. Thank you. And by God's grace, I've resisted the temptations that I faced to be unfaithful for 44 years. I kept my marriage vows, and by God's grace, I intend to be faithful to my wife, Sherry, for as long as I live. And I have some very strong reasons for that. Number one, I love our Lord Jesus Christ. I owe him my life. He died for me. He purchased my salvation by sacrificing his life for me. He literally died in my place. How could I betray his love or smear his reputation in this community? Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So I will keep his commandments because I love him. Secondly, I love my wife and family. The thought of hurting them and betraying their trust, no way. There's no way. It's even unbearable to even think about the damage that my unfaithfulness would do to my family. There's no way I would inflict that on them. Third of all, I love all of you and all those I've served as a pastor. And I realize if I went down the path of adultery, I would hurt and wound you. I wouldn't want my disobedience to be a stumbling block to your faith. And I certainly don't want to give anyone, I don't want to be anyone's excuse for distrusting Christ and his love and his gospel and his church. And fourth of all, I fear the judgment of God. The book of Proverbs says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom and the fountain of life, turning a man from the snares of death. We all need a healthy fear of God. We need to understand, we will not be an exception to the consequences of sin. Now, let me hasten to say, I'm not afraid of losing my salvation. I know I am a child of God, but I also know that God disciplines the child that he loves. I know what the Bible says. If you commit sexual sin, you will not get away with it. Satan tries to make you think you can, but you can't. God says you will reap what you sow. Look at this verse in Hebrews 13, verse 4. God will judge those who are immoral and those who commit adultery. You don't get away with sin. There are always consequences. And I don't want to give God any reasons to take me out to the woodshed. So here's the third thing you can do to airfare-proof your marriage. You need to maintain your marriage. Now, I have to be brief at this point. this could not only be a whole sermon, this could be a whole marriage series, and I would love to do that, have done that in the past, and we'll do that again. But I need to understand at this point, like a garden, everything in marriage needs maintenance in order to grow. Maintaining a healthy, growing relationship with your spouse will reduce the power of temptation to commit adultery. 1 Corinthians 7:3 says this, "The husband should fulfill his wife's sexual needs, and the wife should fulfill her husband's needs." The Bible teaches that spouses have the responsibility to meet one another's needs. The Bible addresses specifically this in regard to the need for sex, but this principle applies to other needs as well. Meeting the needs of our spouse is one of the most important ways that we can express our love to them. Dr. Willard Hardy, a marriage counselor, wrote a fantastic book that I've used in numerous counseling time sessions as well as in sermon preparation. It's a book called His Needs and Her Needs. He's identified the top five needs of most men and the top five needs of most women. And the top five needs of men, generally speaking, are this. Number one, sexual fulfillment. Number two, relational companionship. Number three, an attractive spouse. Number four, domestic support. Number five, admiration. Now, it might vary the order, and there might be a little difference in maybe number six or seven could be in someone's top five. But those are the top five, generally speaking, for men. The top five needs for most women are affection and conversation, honesty and openness, and financial support, and number five, family commitment. Did you notice, as I went over those top five needs, they're completely different? Not one of them is repeated in one list or the other. God planned it that way, friends. We need to make it a priority to learn what our spouse's needs are, and they are likely to be very different than our own. Learning your spouse's needs and doing your best to meet those needs goes a long way in protecting your marriage. The Apostle Paul offered this counsel in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. He says, "Do not deprive each other of sexual relations unless you both agree that you have a headache tonight." No, it doesn't say that. "Unless you both agree to refrain from sexual intimacy for a limited time so you can give yourselves more completely to prayer." Afterwards, it's like you decided you're going to fast from sex to devote yourselves to prayer. That's the one exception here. "Afterward, you should come together again." Now, why? Why is this only for a limited time? So that Satan won't be able to tempt you. The Bible says that sexual fulfillment is a spiritual responsibility in marriage. To deny each other or to reject each other is to cause our mates to be more vulnerable to temptation. I heard about a scientific survey recently that was done to discover what days men most like to make love. They discovered that men prefer to have sex on every day that begins with a T, like Tuesday, Thursday, today, tomorrow, Tatterday, and Tunday. When you committed your life to one another in marriage, you're committing to an exclusive relationship. You're saying, for most of the needs I have in my life, especially those in that list of top five, I'm going to be looking to you. You're the one who can meet those needs. And it comes to sexual fulfillment. You're the only person on earth that can righteously meet that need. Unfortunately, many men and women feel deprived and denied. There's poor communication going on about how to meet one another's needs, and as a result, there's conflict in the bedroom, and it spills over into the rest of the relationship. Here's a decision that every single one of us who are married needs to make in our marriage. If my mate is going to have a good lover in his or her life, I'm going to be it. When a husband and wife genuinely try to meet one another's needs, they're doing the right thing, and they're going a long way to affair-proof their marriage. The goal of our marriage, Sherry and I, is for us to be best friends. I've heard a quote by Mary Alda, the wife of actor Alan Alda. She said, "It's real easy to leave your spouse. It's not easy to leave your best friend." So in addition to being your spouse's lover, you need to be their best friend. You need to work at it. And how you build that friendship, you spend time having fun together because friends laugh together. You spend time serving one another because friends are helpful to one another. You spend time talking because friends share the things that are going on their heart. Meeting one another's needs will take spending time and being the best lover you could be. Those are two important ingredients. We could go on, as I said, but let me leave you with those two. Number four, manage your mind. Manage your mind. People don't just fall into immorality. There's no such thing as a one-night stand, because that immoral thought life was in place long before the opportunity for the one-night stand ever appeared. You're not a moral, upright person one day and then like that falling into immorality. It just doesn't happen that way. There's a process, a whole series of events that lead to an affair. So affairs don't just happen. They develop. First of all, they develop by accepting sinful thoughts in our minds. Regardless of what the temptation is, the battle begins in your mind. You continually think about it, and eventually you're tempted to act on it. Second is emotional, non-physical involvement. By emotional involvement, I mean you look to another person of the opposite sex other than your spouse to meet your emotional needs. Number three is physical involvement. Once you cross the line of physical contact and put the pull of sexual sin is almost inevitable. So you need to try to break that off right away. Because once a relationship has crossed physical lines, it'll take everything you have plus the grace of God to break out of it. Don't cross that line. Run in the other direction. And then the fourth thing that happens is rationalizing. Rationalizing the affair. You know, and this is also my experience as a pastor. There is almost no limit to the human capacity to rationalize away sin, especially sexual sin. We are great at deceiving ourselves. We are experts in pulling the wool over our own eyes. Jeremiah 17:9 says, "The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked." We are pros at deceiving ourselves. Someone might say, "God wants me to be happy." Yes, he does, and that's why he gave you this rule. He knows you better than you know you, and he knows what it'll take to make you happy. And he's saying you won't find happiness down the path of adultery. In fact, what you will find are some very painful consequences. Someone might say, "But I really love this other woman or man." It's not love. It's not love. Sorry, it's selfishness. Adultery is ultimately selfishness. It's saying, "I'm going to put my needs and my pleasure ahead of everything else. I'm going to put it ahead of what God says. I'm going to put it ahead of what my husband and wife and how they will be impacted. I'm going to put myself and my needs and my happiness ahead of my family, ahead of what it will do to the other person's family, ahead of what it will do to the other person's spouse." It's basically saying, "Forget everybody else. I'm doing what pleases me." That's selfishness. Don't call that love. When our passions are stirred and our foolish hearts are darkened by sin, we can rationalize and convince ourselves that almost anything is okay. No matter how wrong it is. Worse, we foolishly think we'll be an exception to God's discipline and judgment. I want you to know that God's commands in regard to sexual sin are timeless. Adultery is always wrong and a violation of God's commands. Fornication, always wrong and a violation of God's commands. Pornography is always wrong and a violation of God's commands. That's why when it comes to this sin, we are so wise to run in the opposite direction. 2 Timothy 2:22 says, flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. To do that, we need to, number five on my list is maintain some appropriate relationships. Got to have appropriate boundaries in our relationships. Most affairs occur between close personal friends or co-workers, so it's very important to maintain and establish some healthy boundaries. Like, don't listen to the member of an opposite sex describe his or her marital problems. You may think that you can be a good listener. You may think you can be sympathetic, but this is a dangerous scenario. As quickly as you can, steer the other person to a counselor of their same gender. A young, attractive woman came to church. She was brand new at the church, and soon after coming, she was not a Christian. She came and made an appointment to visit with me, and she began to tell me her marriage problems. And I said to her after one meeting, you need to start meeting with my wife. And they met. She became a Christian, and a marriage was saved. Don't try to be someone's savior when it comes to their need and their description of their broken relationship. Direct them to someone as soon as possible who can give them wise counsel, who's of the same gender. Number two, be very careful with compliments to members of the opposite sex, because you could send suggestive signals that you do not even intend to send. Your spouse is the person who needs your praise and admiration. Number three, be aware of electricity between you and a member of the opposite sex. When there's some kind of special chemistry and magnetism, all of a sudden, without meaning for it, you notice that there's some sparks that are flying here between you and another person. You need to pull back immediately and get some distance between you and the lure of temptation. And if it persists, you need to talk to another Christian who can hold you accountable and pray for you. Number four on my list would be avoid flirting. Whether it's playful teasing or prolonged staring, it's called flirting. You're married, and since you're married, your flirting days are over. It's misleading. Number five, avoid a lingering touch. Again, there are socially acceptable boundaries in our culture of what's appropriate touch. But if a person hugs you too long or touches you in a way that makes you feel uncomfortable, it's a dead giveaway that they have an agenda. Don't do it. Don't do it to someone. And keep your guard up if someone attempts to cross the line with you. Ephesians 5, this is an important verse. Catch this verse. Ephesians 5, verse 3. It says, but among you there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality. Would you find this verse in your notes, and would you underline not even a hint? That means you're going to be committed to maintaining appropriate boundaries. Number six on my list is minimize the opportunity. If you don't want to get stung, then you need to stay away from bees. Don't place yourself in situations where you know you're going to be tempted. Recognize the circumstances that challenge your convictions and your standards or that cause you to be aroused, and get away from them. Avoid them. Proverbs 7, verse 7 and 8. It's a long passage that in context here I would love to preach on, but for the sake of time, I just jump into this. But the wise Solomon says, I saw among the simple, I noticed among the men, a youth who lacked judgment. I want to underline that phrase, who lacked judgment. He was going down the street near her corner, and he gets involved in a sexually immoral relationship, but it begins with his lack of judgment of going in the direction of the temptation. Steer yourself in a different, safer direction. Number one, don't overestimate your self-control. Don't play with fire. Anyone can fall. 1 Corinthians 10, 12 says, if you think you are standing strong, be careful. You too may fall into the same sin. Number two, choose your friends carefully. 1 Corinthians 15, 33 says, bad company corrupts good character. Most affairs occur between couples that already know each other. So choose to fellowship with people who are committed to their marriage. Number three, keep your guard up. Malachi 2:15 says, guard yourself in spirit and do not break faith with your wife. Now, as I close today, if you've already crossed the line into sin, you need to get back on the right path here immediately. Don't buy the devil's lies any longer. He's hiding the price tag. You may not have had to pay it yet, but the price tag will come due if you continue down a promiscuous or unfaithful path. So let me talk to you about the way back to purity. First of all, you need to acknowledge your sin. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. You need to call sin what it is. It's a sin, and you confess it to God. Number two, you end the relationship immediately. Hebrews 12, verse 1, the second part of that verse says, we should remove from our lives anything that would get in the way and the sin that so easily holds us back. Would you find Hebrews 12, 1 in your notes, and would you underline that phrase, remove from our lives? Sever the relationship immediately. Immediately, don't put it off. Number three, avoid all contact with the other person from now on. You need to go in separate directions. Romans 13, 14 says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Make no provision for the flesh. In other words, don't leave the back door open. Unfriend them on social media. Don't keep the person's name and number in your contact list. Be very intentional about going a different direction. Do this, whatever it takes. Jesus said, if your eye causes you to sin, it's better to lose an eye than to lose your soul. He's saying, we'd be wise to take radical steps to lead pure lives. Friends, God thought up sex. It's his idea. In marriage, it is wonderfully and fantastically a beautiful expression of love. But improperly, it destroys marriages. It damages families and lives. It damages self-respect, creates misery and guilt and shame and regret and depression, not to mention all the kinds of communicable diseases that are out here today. God says, I've established these rules for your benefit. If you don't play by my rules, you will get hurt. God's way is best, and you need to go God's ways and get back on the right track. You can open your life to Jesus this morning and say, Jesus, I need you to come into my life. I need you to manage my life. I need you to be the Lord and leader of my life. I need you to manage, among other things, my sex drive. Because I want to live the life you want me to live. Ask for forgiveness for past mistakes. Ask for forgiveness for sins. And then you need to go down the road of learning to forgive yourself. Make a commitment to be morally pure the rest of your life from this day forward. That means that you're going to reserve sex only for the person you're married to. Would you bow with me for prayer? Father in heaven, I thank you. I thank you for grace and second chances. I thank you that you're a God that forgives, cleanses, and heals. So, Lord, I pray that you would pour out your grace upon us this morning. For those who are feeling the guilt and shame of past sexual sins, Lord, I just thank you for your word again that says, because of what Christ did for us on the cross, there is now no condemnation on us. All of that condemnation for our sin was nailed to the cross. Thank you. Thank you for your forgiveness. And now, Lord, we want to reaffirm our commitment to live by your standards. Lord, I want to pray as pastor for your protection, your hedge of protection over the marriages in this church. I want to pray your hedge of protection over the families in this church. Lord, I pray that you will help us to encourage one another to have the right kind of relationship with our spouse, full of love and forgiveness, lots of grace. I pray, Father, that we'll have the kind of marriages in this church that remind us of your description of your love for your bride in the book of Ephesians. I pray that we'll have that kind of love here. I pray that there'll be security, there'll be faithfulness, and a mutual commitment to live according to your standards. Father, I pray especially for those who are making a fresh start today, that you help them, that you encourage them, and I pray that they're walking in purity from this day forward. For the person who's never said yes to Jesus, I pray this might be the day they let go of the shame and the guilt, the burdens of past mistakes, and they lay that at the foot of the cross. If that's you, you might pray a prayer like this. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. Thank you for paying for it in full when you died on the cross for me. I want you to be my Savior, and right now, today, this morning, I put my faith in you and receive you as my Savior. And I want you to forgive my sin, and I will follow you where you lead me, and I will surrender to your leadership for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen.
There is power, power every chain, break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Every chain of every sin. He can break every addiction. He can break the hold that sin has on us. We just need to turn our lives over to Him and seek His forgiveness, seek His leadership. If you're new with us or back again, you've maybe forgotten how we often have communion after our service. We're going to continue to do that. So right down front on this side, communion will be served if you'd like to have an opportunity to meet around the Lord's table and reflect on what He did on the cross for you before you leave today. Just come down and on the table you'll find little pieces of bread and cups of juices that are wrapped together in individual containers, and then take a seat, and someone will be leading the communion time there in just about 5 minutes after we close here. And again, as Kevin reminded us, there's a prayer request. In addition to the offering envelopes that are at the offering boxes, if you have a prayer request that you would like to leave with us, we will share that with our prayer team and be praying for you this week. Let's stand for a closing prayer. Father, we thank You for Your goodness and love. We thank You for Your grace and mercy. We thank You for our chance to be here today. And Lord, we thank You for the power that's in Jesus' name. Thank You that we have been forgiven. Thank You that we are clothed in righteousness because of Your amazing grace. Thank You that Your sacrifice at the cross paid for our sin in full. Now, Lord, I pray You'd help us to live lives worthy of the calling that You've placed upon us, to live our lives as the children of God, walking in the footsteps of Jesus. It's in His name that we pray. Amen. Make it a great day.